Well, good morning. Glad you joined us again today that we might worship the Lord together. Even in the midst of days, being as they are, we know things are so different, but we're thankful that much is the same because Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, forever. Well, pray today the ministry of music and the Word of God might encourage your heart, and God might prepare to use you even in this day as He pleases to do. So might we join our hearts together and look to the Lord in prayer as we begin. Father, thanking you again for this privilege of joining together. Lord, our hearts are mindful of all the different things that are going on in our lives and around our world. And Lord, we know that as God's people, we need a gathering place. We need to gather at your feet that we might learn from you. Lord, may we be faithful in proclaiming the truth of Jesus Christ in song and in word today. Lord, change us, make us the people that you might use for your honor and glory in the day in which we're living. Prepare us for that somewhat today. I'd ask and pray. Amen. Amen.
Salvation. Oh, even here.
Thank you again for that praise team. Appreciate it very much. Though our sins be many, his mercy is more. Well, that certainly is a song that we would apply not only to our own lives, but certainly to our study today. And because though Jacob's sins were so many, God's grace, his goodness, his mercy was far greater still. Paul writes that writes about that in the book of Romans. And God's grace, his mercy, his goodness outweighs anything that we can do. And how gracious God is and how grateful we are that is indeed the case. We're continuing our message today, the School of Hard Knocks, looking at God's enrollment of Jacob into a school of lifelong learning where he'll learn lessons that will do him well for the rest of his life. You and I know what it is to get into situations, experiences where things are difficult, things are hard, where they're hurtful maybe. But those lessons that we experience, if we experience them with God, those experiences become our profit in the days ahead. It becomes the things that God uses in our lives to shape us, to make us the men and women that God wants us to be. Already, and don't forget that God wants you to do well. God wants to take your life, Christian, and to shape it, to mold it into the image of Jesus Christ. And no matter what we're facing, regardless of the situation or the timing in our lives or the weight of the event, no matter what it is, God is able to come in and teach us what he needs us to learn in that time. We must be so mindful of that, because otherwise things come into our lives and they come to crush us. They come to ruin us, really destroy us. And that's never God's intent. Anytime God allows something to come into our lives, he wants to take that situation, use it in us to make it most profitable. And that certainly is a lesson that we learn in the life of Jacob. Let's begin with a word of prayer and we'll get into the scriptures together today. Father, thanking you again for this time and the scriptures. Thank you for the life of Jacob that you've held up for us to look at. Lord, we see so much of ourselves in Jacob. We see so much of others in Jacob because in Laban and the rest of the characters that we look at in the scripture here. Lord, because so many times we don't act well or others don't act well toward us. And Lord, sometimes we think that's an evidence of the fact that you're not around or you don't care. And Lord, that certainly wasn't the case in Jacob's life, and it isn't the case in our lives. Help us to see that there's a Heavenly Father over it all. That Lord, when you allow us to go through things that are difficult and hard, you allow it, Lord, for our good. Lord, for your ultimate glory. Help us not to be discouraged and depressed in the days in which we're living, when there's so much to be discouraged about. But Lord, as God's people, we have a great hope in Jesus Christ. We have life, Lord, that lifts us up above the things of this world. And Lord, like Paul writes to the Colossians, Lord, may we set our affections, our hopes, our aspirations on the things of heaven. Not in the things of this world, not in the circumstances around us, but in the God of all, the one who controls all, the one who's above all. So Lord, today as we open up the Word of God, would you lift up our hearts and our minds? Lord, may you work in us, may you change us and continue to make us the people that would best serve you, honor you, and glorify you. And we'll give you the thanks for it. In your most holy name we pray. Amen. Well, take your Bibles with me this morning again and open up the scriptures with me in the book of Genesis. Book of Genesis. And we want to open up to, for our study today, chapter 30. That'd be a good place to be at. We're covering a few chapters here. So as you're turning there, I'll just make a couple of comments. I won't go all the way back, but just a couple of comments on where we've been in this study. We're looking at the life of Jacob. He was a man that God chose before he was born. And we can't forget that, although we may not find God ourselves or experience new life in Christ until maybe even later in life, the truth is, from God's perspective, he chooses us long before we're born. Matter of fact, go to Ephesians 1, 4 to 6. It says, He chose us in Him before the foundations of the world. Think about that one. Before He even framed the world, He had you and I in mind, and He chose to have us unto Himself. So we weren't an afterthought with God. We were certainly what we call a beforethought. And God had purpose in it. That's what we learned. He had purpose. He determined to have us as His sons and daughters, and to glorify Himself through that. So folks, anytime God does that, we can be assured, even as Jacob could, that God was in control. God had great purpose in His life. And God has great purpose in our lives in the fact that He chooses us. Secondly, we looked at the fact that not only God chose him before he was born, but God also converted him. We said it was even later in his years, from our perspective, about my age, that probably before Jacob even gets saved. And just because God chooses us doesn't mean we grow up with a silver spoon of Christianity in our mouths. It doesn't mean that we act perfect from the first day onward, that we don't have any issues of sin or any struggles that we face. Not at all. As a matter of fact, all the sin and the struggle in our lives prepares us that we might know we need to be saved. And I think that's just what happened in Jacob's life. His sin in his life had come to a head, and he knew there was no more gain in his life as a sinner. And he was prepared, ready to turn away from his sin and to turn to God in heaven, the one who he saw in a dream in Bethel. He saw a ladder going up to heaven, and that ladder was the ladder of salvation. And by faith, that day, Jacob turned his life to the one who sat, the one who stood above the ladder. That's the Lord God himself. And on that day, the Lord affirmed his promises to him, the covenant with Abraham that he made with Abraham. He again affirmed it with Jacob, that he'd give him the land, that he'd give him a seed, and that he'd give him his presence, that he'd never leave him the rest of his life. What a different day that was for Jacob. We said when he woke up that day, he was a worshiper. He was a worshiper of God, and right there he made purpose to worship God. He said, I didn't know God was in this place, but God's here, and I'm here, and I'm a worshiper of the Lord God. And so that follows Jacob the rest of his days. He never forgets that Bethel experience. Just like you and I as a Christian, never forget the fact that we have been saved. Now, we may not look saved at times. We may not act saved at times. We actually may seem to stray from God. But one reality for the Christian is the fact that the Spirit of God abides in every one of us. And He never leaves us. He never forsakes us. As much as we might rebel against God, the Spirit of God abides in us throughout our earthly days. That's a sure reminder to every Christian, even the prodigal, that God's present in them, with them. And Jacob was as well keenly aware of this. While through the rest of Jacob's days, we're talking thirdly here as we began our study last week, God not only chose him and converted him, but now he changes him. And this is going to go on, particularly in our study. It's going to begin here, and this segment of the study for the next 20 years is a process of change for Jacob. Because God's trying to shake the old Jacob out of the man that Jacob now is. There's a lot of the old man in Jacob. There's a lot of his old sinful ways still living inside of him. Though Jacob is saved, we said he's still Jacob. And though you and I are saved, still the old man, the old nature, abides within. And if he's given room, he'll thrive without. We need to be like Jacob and learn the hard way. The hard way is often the way we learn. Learn the hard way how to become the men or the women that God can use in a mighty way. And so we find here God changes Jacob. Jacob will learn to put the old man that he was to death. He'll learn to hate the man he used to be. And in doing that, he's willing to let the old man go and to grab onto the new, walk in newness of life with God. And although that seems to take a long time in his life, you and I will agree with Jacob, spiritual change is not instant in the Christian life. We spend from the day we're saved through the rest of our Christian lives, we spend constantly, progressively changing to become the men and women God wants us to be. How does God do that? Well, for Jacob, he's given us the example. God enrolls him into the school of hard knocks. And there, God will knock off some of the rough edges of Jacob's life. He's chipping away some of the big pieces, some of the big things that held on to Jacob. That's the same way it is with you and I. We become Christians. We might put away some big sins in our lives and maybe struggle at it, but God works in us and puts those sins away. And yet at the same time, if we put these bigger sins away that might be more obvious, the rest of our spiritual lives, God reveals to us the continuation of this process of needing to change. While we might put away a big sin, we might not think the sin of selfishness is such a big deal. And yet it's a very big deal. And so God puts these things away as we live, and he continued the process through the rest of Jacob's life, even as he does in our lives. Well, Jacob's a saved man, but he doesn't necessarily look like it from his actions. By that I mean he doesn't look necessarily like a spiritual man. If you had a conversation with Jacob, there'd be no doubt of the fact that he's very confident of the fact of God's presence with him. God's presence with him is omnipresence. God promised him that. He knew it. Another thing God promised was to provide for him bread for all of his days. God understood, Jacob understood that God was able to provide for him now. Jacob wouldn't have to be stealing and hankering to get things his own way, because God himself pledged to be Jacob's provider. And although we don't find those things put in signs up on the wall, Jacob is very confident of them, and they surface again and again throughout these chapters that we're looking at. So while Jacob doesn't appear to be a very spiritual man, he is indeed a saved man, and the root of it is alive and well in his life. When he leaves Haran, this picture of school of hard knocks, when he graduates from Haran, God will begin to do a much more refining work in Jacob's life, smoothing him out. Now he's knocking off the rough edges. Then God will smooth out his life so that he appears to be much more the servant and the spiritual man, leader in his home that we expect him to be. So let's cut Jacob some slack and look at where he's at, and he's new at it. And let's get into the second aspect of our study. The first one was this: God gave him a lesson in the changing of his wives. Many lessons God taught him in the changing of wives. We know he went to his uncle's home. While there, he arranged to marry the youngest daughter. He said, "I'll work for her 7 years in order to have her." That was his dowry payment. And he did that. He worked the 7 years. He had the wedding. And when he woke up, he'd been tricked into marrying the oldest sister first. The reason was that God was teaching Jacob to respect the rights of the firstborn. There was a custom in the land that the firstborn, Leah, must be given in marriage before the younger, Rachel. And we know in Jacob's home that he had cheated his brother and stolen from his brother, who was the elder. Jacob didn't respect the rights of the firstborn. And he did it carelessly. He did it with much deceit and deception. And he didn't care about it. He was careless about it. And God was teaching Jacob here the pain that comes through such actions. And he was learning his own lesson the hard way. And so he ended up working another 7 years, in order to pay the dowry price and marry Rachel. Now he found himself not with one wife, but with two. That was never a good situation in the scripture. Again, in Jacob's life, the marriage to these two women makes for a very unhealthy, unhappy, unloving situation for one to the other. And it's a difficult and a divided and a home of hatred. It's not a good place when you have two wives. Polygamy never works from God's perspective. And Jacob again learns that even though he was deceived and it happened through that, and that deception causes much pain and discontent in people's lives. And again, he learned, I never want to be the man I was. I never want to be the man that I was. I called that the agony of deceit. He learned the agony of deceit. And that's indeed the lesson that Jacob learns when he marries the two wives. He still gets Rachel, who he loved, but had he been forthright and earlier in life, he wouldn't have had to learn this difficult lesson that he learned in the marrying of two wives. Well, the second lesson we want to look at today that we come upon is this. It's not the changing of wives, but the changing of his wages. The changing of his wages. We said earlier in our study that really Jacob was a deceiver, a double crosser. He did whatever it took so that he would win. And that often meant, from what we understand, that even those who were closest to him were hurt in the process of his getting ahead in life. We know at his birth, he came out grabbing the heel of his brother. And it seems in life, anything he wanted, he grabbed for it, he got it, he took it. He stole it if he needed to. He tricked to get it. But whatever it was, he was going to get it. What we don't see before Jacob gets up to Haran, to his uncle's home, what we don't see with Jacob back at his own home, it's true that he did work, but we see here that Jacob is before us as a servant. It's really symbolic, a picture of the nation of Israel when they would go in the days ahead, and Israel would go down into Egypt under Joseph, Jacob's son. And they would go into Egypt. And you remember what happened there after that generation arose under Jacob and under Joseph, and the king Pharaoh went off and a new Pharaoh came in? The years passed. And it so came that the Pharaoh of Egypt became a hard taskmaster over the people of Israel, where they cried out unto God to free them. What's happening in Jacob's life is a snapshot. It's a symbol of what's going to happen to the nation of Israel in the days of heaven. Because Jacob is really here not as a son, not even as a son-in-law, but he's more like a slave under the burdensome hand, the heavy hand of a father-in-law named Laban, his uncle, who was every much of a schemer, a deceiver, than Jacob ever had been. And Laban is a hard taskmaster to work for. And it's working for him where he will learn to live for God back at home. He'll go back home a different man when he goes. Stopping right here a minute, some of us in the work world, you may find yourself, or you can look back and say, you know, I remember the day when I worked for someone who was a hard taskmaster. I think most of us certainly have experienced that. I think I see sometimes, and sometimes Christians feel, if they work for somebody who's hard to work for, then it's a signal that they've got to get out of there. I don't think that's necessarily the case. God can teach us, but if we're working for a hard taskmaster, or we're working in some ungodly place, friends, that's just the place we need to be a witness for the Lord. Those are just the kinds of people that we need to grow under and learn to survive our Christian faith under. Sometimes we want to get out where the money's good and the job is easy and it's pretty well good business. I've worked for some pretty tough guys, some pretty vulgar men. And I'll tell you, I never looked to say, hey, I got to get a new job. They don't treat me well. No, I really looked to stay and say, you know what? This is a dark place, but I want to be a bright witness in this work. And I'm not talking about my work in the church, by the way. No, I'm talking about my work out in the world. And I've had a few jobs. And really, most of my jobs, as I look back, they've had difficult people that I've had to serve under. And I think God's way is to teach us how to deal with that much more than just saying, nope, I want another job. And I've learned that God blesses that, and I feel that's what we've learned here with Jacob as well. Jacob was faithful to the work, and that's what surprised me as I did the study. I say this about Jacob. In the change in the wages, Jacob is found a faithful worker. Let that sink in. I wonder how his brother would have responded to get a letter back at home from Jacob telling how wonderfully he's enjoying working on the ranch and how many hours a day he's having to work and how hard it is, but how good it is to work and to get his wages that way. I'm putting the two things side by side. One, Jacob is now presented to us as a changed man. He's a faithful worker. And his father-in-law is an unfair boss. He's a hard taskmaster. So here Jacob's working faithfully for a guy who's difficult to work under. That is difficult for him. It certainly is difficult for us. Well, we remember one thing particularly about the money aspect, the earning money and making a living that Jacob understood right from the day he was saved back in Bethel. You remember he made a vow that if God would provide for him, back in Bethel the night he was saved, he made a vow to the Lord that if the Lord would provide for him, amongst other things, then he would give a tenth of all that he made back to God, of all that he received back to God. And right away, God touched him in the area of finances, because that was a big problem in his life. And it was a problem that God needed to give him success in, or give him the ability to have victory in that area. If he was going to earn money now, he was going to earn it in a good and an honest way. Why? Because previously, he had been known to earn things or to take things in a dishonest way. In a dishonest way. And that's the lesson that he's learning here. The difficulty comes in the fact that he works for a hard guy. And he pushes Jacob to the place where Jacob could, and eventually does, act in wrong ways. He resorts by the end of it, he resorts back to the man he was in order to do a little combat with this guy, a little hand-to-hand combat. I mentioned earlier that Laban, his taskmaster, is like Ebenezer Scrooge. Dickens said he was a man with a tight-fisted hand, and rightly so. That's the way Laban is. Laban holds his money tight. He doesn't let it go easy. And if he promises you two, you might get half a one. You might get a buck. But he's going to work it out so that he ends up, if he says he's going to give you two, he ends up with at least one back in his own hand. And that is a difficult situation, but that's where Jacob finds himself at. You know, I don't find that so strange. Turn with me over to the book of Ephesians in the New Testament. Because Jacob is a new man. It's surprising to me how new he looks when we put him beside the Christian and the New Testament language of faith. Because in the book of Ephesians, Paul writes concerning this business of putting on the new man. What does it look like as God's child to put on the new life? And he begins here in this chapter, chapter 4 of Ephesians, in verse 24, and Paul writes this, "Put on the new man, which by God is created in righteousness and true holiness." We're going to put on true Christianity. It's not a mix of unholy and holy, of just ways and unjust ways. No. We're created by God in Christ Jesus, for the purpose of being created unto righteousness and holy living. What does that look like? Drop down to verse 28. To put on the new man, it's like this. And you'd think this was speaking of Jacob, but it's speaking of you and I, as God's people. "Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, working with his hands, the thing which is good." That's what Jacob is doing. Jacob is holding a good and honest job. He's making his pay. He's purchasing, providing for his family, just as God intends for a man to do or a family to do today. And it says at the end of that, that he might have to give to him that needeth. So the man who stole becomes a new man, not when he makes more money and puts it in his pocket. No. The new man makes money that he might have money and that he might earn money, but that he might give his money away. Not when he stops being a thief, but when he becomes a generous giver. That's the sign of a Christian that's really living the new life. And that's the contrast we see here. It talks beforehand in verse 25 about putting away lying. When does a man become a truth teller? Not when he stops telling lies, but when he begins telling the truth again and again and again. And Jacob is learning now not to steal what he wants, but to earn that which he wants to have. And that is definitely true of Jacob and money. And by the way, isn't what we do earning money, accumulating wealth, how we deal with it, how we spend it, how we disperse it, if we give or don't give, if we're generous or not, isn't that a big deal in our lives today? Particularly as Christians, we understand God gives us all that we have, whether it's the clothes on our back or the money in our pocket or the homes that we live in or the cars we drive. It all belongs to God. He gives it to us. The moment we die, we lose it all. We leave it all behind. It's very temporary. But in the having of it, God teaches us how to manage our spiritual lives. And what we do with our money, the things that we buy, where we deposit it or don't, it tells a lot about who we are as God's people, or who we aren't. And so that's why I wanted to put that beside the fact that before we look at Jacob's wages, that Jacob himself is a faithful worker. We see it here. After he has his children, most of them that is, he says, I'm in the same chapter 30 now, back in Genesis. Sorry, I'm leaping backward on you. Turn back to our study, if you would, with me in chapter 30. Jacob has had his family now. Almost all his children have been born. He's settled a good number of years here in the land of Haran. And he's ready to go back home. He wants to go back home. He wants to provide for his own family back home, which he's intended to do ever since he arrived in Haran. Now that he's got his wives and his children, he's ready to go back. So he approaches his father-in-law, Laban, and he says in verse 26, "Time's up. Give me my wives and children for whom I have served you, and let me go. For thou knowest the service which I've done to you." What's he saying? You know how good I worked for you. I've been a good worker. Look down at verse 30. He said, "When I came, you had nothing. Your business, your ranch was small." Look at verse 30. "For it was little which you had before I came." He points to what he has now. He says, "And now, look at the ranch. Now it's increased to a multitude. The Lord's blessed you because of me." And so Jacob looks at it very honestly before Laban. Laban wouldn't deny it, couldn't deny it. He loved it, because having this boy in the farm had really increased all his cattle, his goats, his sheep. They had done well. He had increased mightily under the keeping and the care of Jacob. And the reality is, although Jacob is ready to go back home and continue to work for a living, provide for his family, Laban isn't willing to lose him just yet. We'll come to that in a minute. The problem is, maybe Jacob would have wanted to stay. I don't know. In a good way, long term, we know that wasn't God's plan for Jacob, so he didn't. But the reality is, he wasn't in a position of wanting to stay in that job because he was used in that job and abused in that job. Now, I don't care who we are, Christian or not, none of us like being in a position in our work where we are mistreated and robbed, cheated, particularly in the environment of the work world, employer and employee, that is. And certainly there's a lot of that going on in our country and our land and our time, but it's never profitable to us. We don't enjoy that. And look here what Jacob says. When the time comes, this is 6 years down the road from our present study. When the time comes for them to, thereabouts, for them to finally leave, Jacob says to his wives, I'm looking in chapter 31, if you turn there with me for a moment, in verse 7. Verse 6, he says, he reminds his wives that how good he'd worked. He says, and you know that with all my strength I have served your father. Now, that's a good testimony. His wives knew how long and hard and earnestly Jacob had served Laban, even though Laban was the most difficult man to work for. Sometimes in-laws are like that. Not always, but sometimes. They're difficult to deal with. And he reminds the girls here, saying, you know how I served your father with all my strength. In verse 7, but your father has deceived me. I've worked hard for him. I've given him everything I had, but he's deceived me, verse 7, and changed my wages 10 times. That was the problem. That's where the school of hard knocks comes into play. That's where the rubber met the road. Jacob learned to be on the wrong end of the stick, if I can put it that way, or the short end of the stick. Jacob learned the hard way of what it was like to have someone take advantage of who you are. But you and I remember back in the day when Jacob was cooking the stew and his brother came in famished from working out in the field, hard work. And you'll remember, won't we, how his brother took advantage of him in that moment of weakness and took the birthright, coaxed it out of him. And then later in life, with the blessing, how he literally went and through deception stole it to get it. Jacob's learned here that even though his father-in-law has treated him this way, he understands that he's getting a taste of his own medicine. He understands that he's being treated just as he treated those back in his own family when he was back home in Canaan. And changed my wages 10 times. I like the way one commentator wrote on it and said you can be sure that it wasn't a raise in pay that Jacob got those 10 times. You ever been in a job where you get commission money? Or maybe piecework? You've done piecework? Where you get paid by the piece that you do or the amount of work you accomplish? I certainly have, and I tell you, when you open your paycheck and you get that paycheck and you look at it, and it's altogether different from what you thought it should be or you know it should be. All of a sudden there rises up in you the feeling that Jacob had rising up in him. Your boss is going at it again, playing the figures, that he wins and you lose. Well, many of us have experienced that kind of thing in life. And that's what we have here. Jacob said, you know what? We've agreed again and again for a certain wage, and I come up on the losing end again and again. That's what he did. Now, I want you to notice something, and this is one of those instances where Jacob could honestly say to his wives, yeah, Laban meant it for evil, like Jacob would, Joseph would say to his brothers down the road. Yes, Laban meant to do me no good. Matter of fact, later he says this, Laban would have sent me away empty, broke, if he had his way about it. That was his goal. He didn't want Jacob to get anything if he had his way about it. But notice the end of this verse with me. It's critical. It's vital to understand who the man Jacob is. Your father had deceived me and changed my wages 10 times, but God suffered him not to hurt me. That word hurt means to destroy me, is the thought here. To ruin me, to break me. Because Laban wasn't treating him kindly to keep him. He was taking advantage of him again and again. And he says this, unless God had stepped in, he would have done what he tried to do. But God assured one thing. God assured the fact that I'd have enough to live on. God assured enough I'd make my wages. And I put my faith in that. That's the God who Jacob served. Question is this. Did God keep his promise from back at Bethel? I will provide for you. Let's go back and look at that just one more time. Let's go back and look at that promise that he made, particularly in chapter 28, verse 15. Just after he confirms the covenant that he made initially to Abraham, and now gives it to Jacob. He says in verse 15 of chapter 28, "And behold, I am with you. I will keep you in all places where you go. And I will bring you again into this land. For I will not leave you until I have done that which I have spoken unto you." And we come down a little further. Verse 20. Jacob vowed a vow when he woke up and worshiped. He made a vow saying, "If God be with me and will keep me in the way that I shall go and will give me bread to eat and raiment to put on so that I come again to my father's house," he says this, "then I'm going to follow this God of mine." And he is. When we find him in the land of Haran, in his father-in-law's home, he is indeed following his God, the God of heaven, the God of Isaac, the God of Abraham. And God is faithful to him. And God's faithful to you and I today. He's teaching him in the changing of wives. God's teaching him in the changing of wages. What is he learning? He's learning that I don't need to scheme to get things. God will provide. My God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory. Paul writes to the Philippians chapter 4:19. We need to know and understand in our day, when we get stressed out with finances, when there doesn't seem to be much left or enough to go around, God is as faithful to us as he was to Jacob. And we can understand that. He will never leave us. He will never wrong us or allow us to be wronged in that sense. God is the one in whom we must trust. Well, there's one more area that I'll leave with you today as we finish. He learned lessons in the changing of wives. He learns lessons in the changing of the wages. He learned to be a faithful worker. He learned that God will provide. He doesn't need to cheat and scheme to get it. But we have a little relapse or fall back into the old nature in this story of Jacob because we learn there's a lesson of waiting. There's a lesson of waiting. We need to wait for God and his timing. And if we're not willing to wait, we're going to push ahead and we're going to get in trouble. And while God may have had it prepared, a good time for him to leave, Jacob decided to take advantage of Laban before he left work that day, if I can put it that way. When he came and said, "Hey, I've got my wives and my kids. Let us go back to our own country." Jacob wasn't willing, I said, to let him go, not so quickly. And God is going to teach him that he isn't thoroughly dependent on God yet. While he's told his wives, "Indeed, God has kept me," and God did keep him. In a little while, Laban's going to come after Jacob, and he wants to kill him, I think. He certainly comes after him with evil intentions. And God gives him a dream and says, "Stop here. Don't touch Jacob." So this reality of God providing is no small thing in Jacob's life. But when he says in chapter 30, verse 26, where he says here, Laban says, "Yes, you have been a blessing to me. I know you want to go, but here, you name your price," verse 28, Whatever you name for a price, I'll give you a new wage. Again, he offers them a change. And they do strike up that deal. And it's not an honest one. Not an honest one, no doubt from Laban's end, but it's not an honest one for Jacob's end. Because Jacob looks at this opportunity and says, you know what? He's had me for the last time. I'm going to get him before I leave this place. And the rest of the chapter here, Jacob comes up with another scam whereby he'll stay, he agrees to stay and to work and to take a portion of cattle and the sheep and the goats for himself for pay. But he's going to make sure before the deal's done, before he goes out the door, he's going to make sure that he wins and Laban loses. Look at the end of the chapter. When the cattle were feeble, he put them not in. So the feeble were Laban's. He gave the weak, stragglers, feeble cattle to Laban. And the stronger were whose? Jacob's. That's the way it was. He went out on a bad note. He'd done so well for so long. And here we find this dark cloud over Jacob as he prepares to leave. Because on the way out, he does his father-in-law wrong. And when his father-in-law finds out that he did wrong, next verse, last verse there says, the man Jacob, he increased exceedingly, had much cattle, servants, maidservants, manservants, camels, and donkeys. He had everything, and he even had more than Laban. And he says, girls, pack up the bags, time to go. Well, I'll tell you, that didn't make Laban any too happy about Jacob. And we'll look at that again as we come together in a couple of weeks. We'll get back to this. I'm going to bring a different message next week to you. But as we look at this, we understand one thing. God wants us to learn to do well, even when it's hard, even if we're wrong. If someone does us wrong, it doesn't give us permission to do wrong back. We've been looking on Wednesday nights. Jesus said, but I say unto you, love your enemies. Do good to those who persecute you. Those are the Beatitudes. That's the characteristic of a godly man or a godly woman. We learn to deal with difficulty in a godly way. That is God shaping the man, making the man, so that he can use the man or the woman that God wants us to be. And that's what God had done with Jacob. I'm asking the question as we finish today, is that what God's doing in your life right now? Whatever difficulties we're facing, whatever struggles are in our families, in our workplaces, maybe personally in our hearts, maybe even a time of difficulty for us, discouragement, where it'll be easier to do something different. Are we willing to trust God in all of this? In every season of this journey for Jacob, I learned this too. There was always the lesson of waiting. Waiting on God. Jacob had not been a very patient man with people or with God. And God's teaching him to wait. Wait 14 years to get Rachel. Waiting another series of years at the end to get his increase of pay. He's waiting away. He's waiting for God to say, okay, Jacob, pack up the family. It's time to come back. That's our next study in this that we'll be coming back to in chapter 31, verse 3. God says, come on home. We're finally here. He was waiting 20 years. How long have you been in your present situation? How long do we find ourselves there? 3 weeks? 6 months? 10 years maybe? Maybe longer. But in that season of waiting, God is teaching us to depend on Him. Scripture say in the Psalms that those who wait on the Lord, God does them well. The prophet Isaiah wrote in chapter 40 that those who wait on the Lord shall renew their hope. The Psalms again teach us that those who wait on the Lord have hope in Him. Friends, if God has us in a difficult season today, may we find ourselves not looking at the situation, but waiting on God to intervene. Oh, He's faithful. He will. May we be faithful in the meantime. God bless you. Look forward to being with you again next time. We're going to begin next week bringing you the services from the summer services we're having at Rick's house, Chapel in the Woods. And so we're going to try taping right from there and bringing that to your home for a season that you might join us in that way. So look forward to joining with you next time. But may God be with you as He is with us in the meantime. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for Your promises. Lord, we thank You for these real life lessons. Lord, we're struggling with lots of different things in these days. But Lord, everything we struggle with, You can bring us through. You see it. You see us. You see us when we're wronged. You see us when we do wrong. Lord, may You teach us to be the men and women You want us to be. And may we prove to be faithful servants of the Lord in it all. Lord, bless us today. Change us in a good way, Lord. Make us to be obedient to Your word, to be sensitive to what the Holy Spirit's saying. Then, Lord, use us to cause us to respond well, to look to You for direction, guidance. Lord, that we too might know what it is to follow You. All of these days, being a blessing, even as You're such a blessing to us, we'd ask and pray, amen. Look forward to seeing you next time. God bless.